And I've been, you know, running around, picking up sort of what's going on. So that's the basis on which I do this. And just to sort of first of all put them into context, as violent jihadist groups go, I mean, there is a vast range. We tend, I think, to put them all in a box. You know, there's just a lot of violent jihad out there. But of course, it's not like that if you are living in the region. So, to give you an example, at the bottom end of the scale, I had a friend in Islamabad telling me about a situation he had in his village where they have quite a big family and they have their own mosque. And tend to, if they can get there for the weekend, they'd be praying there on a Friday. And then some local lads, a group of three local lads, came about a year ago, armed, and said, we're taking over the mosque. This is just after Friday prayers. So he's like, you know, this is our family mosque. And I know these three lads, they're local lads, and I wasn't particularly intending to let them take it over. So he said, you know, he's a big man, he's a powerful man, and he can look after himself. So he got his family to surround these three boys, disarm them, beat them, strip them, and lay them in his back room, dragged them to a room, and then rang up their parents and said he can come and fetch them. So that was a militant group that never got started. Three lads who were left humiliated, taken home. Then you get up to the next stage. I mean, I'm more familiar with Pakistan than anywhere else, where you get local groups who will have, you know, 50, 60 members and be, you know, doing local grant and asserting themselves locally. And then, you know, gradually up to the Premier League groups in Pakistan, you know, six or seven groups who could, you know, organise, you know, significant bombing on a specific target next week, sort of thing. And there'll be six or seven groups who are, you know, will have thousands of men under arms, and the organisational capacity and the, you know, just the wherewithal to mount that kind of major attack at short notice. And then above them, you've got these two global, massive, powerful groups, each with tens of thousands of supporters, if not, you know, even hundreds of thousands of supporters around the world. So, yeah, there's a whole range of stuff going on, and the important thing to understand is they all have different purposes, different sectarian affiliations, different ideas about what they're trying to achieve, some fighting in Kashmir, some fighting for Islamic law, some fighting for criminal reasons. So there's a whole array of reasons why these groups exist. They all have separate leadership structures, separate funding arrangements, and they're all very different, and they're often in conflict with each other. And so when we just tend to think of these groups as putting them all in a box with violent jihad, it's like putting the whole of British politics into one box and just saying, oh, they're all like politicians over there. It's just, it's a hopelessly broad way of looking at it. So you do need to try and sort of follow what's going on in each particular group. And if you look at these two groups, and there's no question they have had a massive impact since they started quite recently. And over the last 15 years of conflict, I think we sometimes forget just how much things have changed. So there are now, you know, most people in this room would be unable to go to large parts of the world now. That's new. You simply could not visit towns, even cities, in many Middle Eastern countries without fear of being kidnapped and killed. And so the power of the West is so hugely reduced that there are, you know, it is even affecting our freedom of movement. And Western politicians now, when they try and talk of how this is all going and declare victory, as politicians like to do, you know, they are reduced to basically saying there are no attacks at home. That is now the definition of victory, that if there are some years where there are no attacks in the UK, that is considered a success. Capital cities, major cities, have now lost control. Damascus, Tripoli, Baghdad, they no longer control the territory around them. You even have a situation now with the oil industry, where significant oil exports are coming out of Islamic State, out of Kurdish regions of Iraq, out of tribally held areas of Libya, and it is impossible, apparently, for the big powers to stop that. So it's an extraordinary loss of control, that even on something as fundamental as the movement and sale of oil around the world, that that has been given over, that has been won by violent jihadists. And if you think that Islamic State's on the back foot, which it clearly is, I mean, in Syria and in Iraq, Islamic State is facing significant territorial loss. The fact is, they're still very active, and much more active than Al-Qaeda. So if I was to illustrate that with just what happened in the month of January, I've been through the sort of more reliable open source material that's out there and what attacks happened in January. And you know, I would say that both groups would claim much more than this, but these are attacks that you sort of are verifiable-ish. And this is how it goes. Islamic State in January mounted 37 attacks in 9 different countries. So they had attacks in Turkey, Iraq, Syria, Jordan, Yemen, Egypt, Afghanistan, Libya, Somalia. They tried one in Saudi Arabia, but they had 2 suicide bombers there who were shot before they could kill anyone. So in that case, 2 Islamic State people died for nothing. But overall, they killed 393 in these attacks, and at the cost of 30 of their own people. And these are all conservative estimates. These are the verifiable attacks. There will be many, many more attacks. They claim many more attacks in their own territories, which you simply can't get to. So nobody really knows what's happening. And they used, you know, to give you a sense of how competent they and capable they are, they were using, first of all, judicial processes to find people guilty of spying or other crimes. 8 of those, the deaths out of my 393, were the result of judicial processes. 5 in Iraq, a mother and her 4 children burnt alive. In Syria, 2 men accused of being spies were crucified. A man was accused of sorcery and was beheaded. And then at the other end of it, it's car bombs, and the car bomb is by far the most effective weapon they have. 12 attacks killed 199 people. And other things, gunfire, suicide vests, roadside bombs, sticky bombs attached to vehicles, and a new thing in January, a drone strike. So they had a few drone strikes around Mosul, one of which was just sending a drone in with lots of explosives into a target. Then they actually managed to drop a bomb from a drone, so that's a new thing, and kill people doing that. Now, if you then compare what Al-Qaeda did in January, of the sort of verifiable attacks, they had 3 separate attacks, all in Yemen, killed 12 people, all shootings. So nothing like the scale of activity. So you might think that, you know, the world is ISIS's and Al-Qaeda is a thing of the past. I don't think it is quite like that, as I'll explain. Now, just to give you a sense of the rivalry between the groups, this is also from January, a statement from Ayman al-Zawahiri, the guy on the right, so the leader of Al-Qaeda. He said this, and I'll explain why they've got to this point, but this is in a 15-minute audio message, just to give you a sense of how deep the divisions are. He complained, Islamic State was not only running a campaign to defame and undermine Al-Qaeda, but also ignoring his advice on targeting. And they now have quite open exchanges of insults between the 2 groups. So how did all this emerge? Well, let's just deal with Al-Qaeda first of all, just on the origins of these groups. So Al-Qaeda, as most of you all know, came out of the anti-Soviet campaign in Afghanistan, so US and Saudi-backed campaign against the Soviet army, successful getting the Soviets out of Afghanistan. And then at that time, in Peshawar, in northwest Pakistan, bin Laden was there, a group of people were there, and there was this immense burst of organizational activity, but also intellectual activity, as these men met and discussed how they could advance global Islam, globalist Islamism. And they came up with many books, many tracts, many recordings, and produced out of this ferment of ideas, and also with a whole lot of people from all over the world. That was part of it, that people had come to Peshawar from all over the Muslim world, and they produced this idea of Al-Qaeda. Islamic State, really its roots go back to a Jordanian Abu Musab al-Zarqawi, who started off with al-Qaeda, and in fact he's an unusual guy. He's always a petty thief, originally jailed in Jordan for a bit, and then he ended up in Afghanistan, and very unusually bin Laden let him set up a training camp without him becoming a formal member of al-Qaeda, paying allegiance to bin Laden. So he already had an independent streak right from the start. He went back to Iraq after the American invasion and started his insurgency there. And most of what we saw on our screens were him beheading some Americans, which he did on screen. But then he also focused on the battle, as he saw it, against the Shias. And that was his main idea. And his idea was that he could, by attacking Shias, provoke them into attacking Sunnis, and then that the Sunnis would fall in line behind him, and he would build support by provoking this conflict in Iraq between Shia and Sunni, and that would strengthen him. And that is precisely what has happened. I mean, whatever you think of this guy, he saw what to do, he did it, and it's worked. He is now dead, he was killed in a drone strike. But the guy who runs Islamic State, as I'll explain, has benefited from his strategy. So then we've got, he was killed, and you've got the movement being taken over by Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, the guy on the left there, who now runs Islamic State. Former US detainee, held in an American camp in Baghdad, kept his head down, and organized in that camp. And when they were released, actually went to that camp, and the guy running it was an American officer who was saying, you know, I said, aren't you afraid these guys are gonna come back to haunt you? And he's like, yeah, I'm terrified they are, but you know, we've got to release them, and I'm doing my best to see that they're okay before they're released. Anyway, I'd love to talk to him now and see what he thinks, but you know, it obviously went terribly wrong, and these people came out of this camp and formed Islamic State. So now one of the questions is, as they came out, and this is like, you know, debated in all the scholarly books that are coming out on this movement now, is the extent to which Baghdadi there, he's clearly a highly religious man, but to what extent is he representing global violent jihad? And to what extent is he representing a resistance to the American occupation by Saddam Hussein loyalists? And there are reasons to think that that is what's going on inside Islamic State. When you see, especially in the early days, how they were taking over a Syrian village, this wasn't just the work of some sort of rough men out of a madrasa. They would go into a village, set up an office, very patient. They would work out who everyone was, landowners, maybe someone who's gay, something they could get some blackmail material on. They would wait slowly, slowly. Eventually they'd press the button, kill the important people, shame the ones they could humiliate, take over the village, and often with a sort of public gesture of something like free bread or cheap fuel or something like that to win people over. It was quite a sophisticated operation. It doesn't tend to be nowadays. Nowadays they tend to go in there and say, you've got 3 days, and if you're not in line, we'll kill you. But at the beginning it was quite sophisticated, and many people thought it had all the signs of Iraqi intelligence operatives at quite a senior level who were able to lay on that kind of campaign to win influence in Syria. And there is a debate among some of the scholars on this as to whether those surviving Saddam Hussein regime former elements, as the Americans would call them, are actually manipulating people like Baghdadi and basically winning power through the manipulation of this jihadi movement, or whether they've become genuine converts to Baghdadi and are now themselves moved from being Saddam Hussein apparatchiks to becoming genuine jihadists. So that's a sort of open debate about which, frankly, and there are people who take very strong views on it, but it seems to be on the basis of very little evidence because we just don't know. So then, just to follow through on what happened to Islamic State, it was in Syria, and this is when the split really emerged. So Baghdadi had sent some people into Syria, a small group, and it was incredibly successful as they fought the anti-Assad campaign, and they became bigger than the Iraqi group, so that the sort of satellite group became bigger than the original IS group in Iraq. And the guy running that was a guy called Jilani, and he wanted independence. So when Baghdadi said, right, I'm coming to take over the Syria group as well, assert my control there, there was resistance, and there was a split. And the Syrian guy was appealing to Zawahiri, saying, tell him to back off. And Zawahiri did tell Baghdadi to back off. He said, it'll be Al-Qaeda in Syria and IS in Iraq. But that settlement was not accepted by Baghdadi. So you've got this split in Syria as to who's in control of the sort of most active part of the jihadist insurgency against Assad. And it was quite a vicious struggle. So you've got people, you've got Zawahiri saying, I simply don't recognize the existence of Islamic State in Syria. And then you've got Islamic State spokesman saying, Al-Qaeda is a pacifist organization, excessively interested in popularity, mass movements and propaganda. It's now become an axe only in its attempt to destroy the caliphate. So an absolutely ferocious dispute between the two groups. And that is where we've got to now, with IS seeing Al-Qaeda as too cautious, as overly theorizing the whole time. Islamic State say, look, we fight, we win, we show Muslims around the world that we can win, we liberate territory, we establish a caliphate, we restore Muslim pride, we enforce correct religious practice, and what do you do in Al-Qaeda? You do nothing. You sit there issuing these tapes and just not providing any firm action on the ground. Look at the, they would say, look at the attacks in January. We've done 37 attacks, we've done three. Al-Qaeda would put it the other way around and say that there's no hurry, and I'll talk more about that later. The important thing is to get people to the correct political and religious position, and in time, they will come to violent jihad and overthrow the Western powers. And you've got to be patient about it. And if you go too quickly, as Islamic State does it, you will risk alienating people. And of course, there is evidence that many people are alienated in Syria and Iraq. I mean, if you go to the people of Mosul now, who are just being liberated from Islamic State, they'll be extremely pleased, I've no doubt, to see the back of this extremely aggressive, violent regime that's been ruling Mosul for the last year or so. So that's Al-Qaeda's view. You've got to take people with you. It's not just in the Syrian-Iraq theater. If you go to North Africa, they're saying the same thing. This is a guy who runs Islamic Maghreb, talking to people in Mali, his forces in Mali. Take a gradualist approach. This is Al-Qaeda. Take a gradualist approach. If you apply Sharia too rapidly, he said, you will lead people to reject their religion. Take it slowly. Take people with you. So that is a significant difference between the two. And if you look at how that's played out in Syria, it's quite important, because the Al-Qaeda loyal group, the Nusra Front, is much more savvy politically. So the Nusra Front, the Al-Qaeda outfit, I mean, technically they said they were disassociated from Al-Qaeda, but it was, let's not go there, it was a feint to sort of for tactical reasons. But in itself shows their ability to do tactical politics. And they have been trying to reach out to other groups. They've been talking to the less religiously extreme groups. They've been trying to create a coalition that will fight Assad. And they've been trying to basically deepen their roots in Syrian society as a whole. Islamic State, by contrast, is much more about using fear, using violence. That's where it's got to the Islamic State, enforcing their will, killing people who don't agree with them, and just saying, in a Takfiri way, take it or leave it. Either you're with us, or you're an infidel and you're dead. And so in Syria, for example, they issued an edict at one stage to Islamic State saying every person who was in the opposition who didn't agree with them was liable to be killed. So it's a much more aggressive approach. So what does all that mean in terms of how this works out as a strategy? So, just to give you another illustration of the differences, this is a sort of a tactical issue which came up last autumn in some of the journals these groups produce. And the issue was, should women be, is it permissible for women to carry out knife attacks? Is it permissible for women to murder people with knives? And Al-Qaeda argued in their thing in September in their publication that it was wrong, and that men should be doing this and they should protect the women, and it's not appropriate for women to be knifing people to death. Islamic State, entirely characteristically, said that's wrong, and then praised some women in, was it Kenya? In Kenya, who had gone in, they got a video of some women stabbing some policemen to death in Kenya. In the autumn, and said, that's the correct thing, and these women had done the right thing. So that's a sort of another illustration of a tactical difference. Now, at the strategic level, there is this significant difference in the thinking between the two groups. So bin Laden's original breakthrough thought was that you should attack the far enemy, as he put it, not the near enemy. And this was his big tactic, his big innovation. And that the problem was, everyone agreed the problem was with the United States, but that he said you just take the fight to the United States, you cut the head of the snake. Whereas the alternative idea is what they've been doing for many, many years before bin Laden came along, which is you tackle your local regime that is abusing you and limiting your human rights and is not allowing you to perform Islam in the way you'd like. So you attack the Saudi royals or the Syrian dictatorship or whatever it is. So that's the distinction between the far enemy and the near enemy, with Al-Qaeda saying you have to go and attack the far enemy. Now, on top of that distinction, there is the question of anti-Shia violence, with Islamic State much more enthusiastic about killing Shias than bin Laden and now Zawahiri running Al-Qaeda. So I mentioned this guy, the Jordanian Abu Musab al-Zarqawi earlier, who'd set up this ISIS, first of all an Al-Qaeda, and then it became an ISIS operation in Iraq. And he, as I say, he was saying, if you kill Shias, we'll get revenge attacks, the Sunnis will be forced into our camp. And Zawahiri directly opposed that, wrote him a letter. So a couple of very interesting letters were captured by the Americans in the course of their occupation of Iraq. And one was Zawahiri asking for money, just quite a sort of amusing letter saying, we're terribly short, you couldn't just send us $50,000, could you? And the second one was saying, please stop killing Shias. It's not a good idea. And I'll read it to you. Without public support, the Islamic Mujahid, so this is Zawahiri talking to the predecessor of this guy. Without popular support, the Islamic Mujahid movement will be crushed, but many of your Muslim admirers amongst the common folk are wondering about your attacks on the Shia. And anyway, you can kill, anyway, can you kill all of the Shia in Iraq? Also, the Muslim populace who love and support you will never find scenes of slaughtering hostages palatable. You shouldn't be deceived by the praise of some of the zealous young men and their description of you as the Sheikh of the slaughterers. They don't express the general view. So that was Al-Qaeda saying, just back off. Stop killing all these Shias. It's really not helping you. It's not helping us. And it is taking us away from, as Al-Qaeda would say, the main enemy, the United States. However, as I said, I think you can argue that Zarqawi's idea was sort of vindicated, because out of what he thought came Islamic State and this extremely powerful movement that took everyone by surprise, took Iraqi cities, took Syrian cities, and has emerged at the moment as stronger than Al-Qaeda. So where is this going now? If you look at Islamic State now, Baghdadi has a number of problems to worry about. So he's facing these significant territorial losses. And you know, the Iraqi army had hoped that they would have cleared Mosul by the end of the year. That was their original intention. I don't know if you're following it on the news, but they launched an offensive yesterday. It's obviously an extremely difficult thing to do, but they presumably, within the next 3 months or something, will have control of Mosul, and the forces around Raqqa in Syria, the Islamic State main city in Syria, are also gathering. That might take longer, but certainly by the end of this year, conservatively, by the end of this year, these two major cities the Islamic State hold should be out of those. And that, of course, affects his air of invincibility, Baghdadi's air of invincibility, and this idea that he is on the winning side, and that will mean that the young lads from East London and Leeds and so on who've been going over to fight for him will be presumably less attracted to do so. The flow of foreign fighters will dry up. He's got another problem, which is that, as I mentioned, his earlier attempt to introduce some sort of good governance in these villages they were taking over, providing welfare, providing, you know, gold trade. They were boasting about letting gold traders trade safely and securely, so law and order, and free bread and all this stuff. All that has gone, really, from what we can understand, in favour of just rule by fear. So there is, there are many, many people who want to be rid of their Islamic State rulers in their villages and their towns. Their income is shrinking. So Kings have just done a study. There's also a lot of sort of guesstimates in this, but they think that in 2014, Baghdadi's income was 1.9 billion. Yeah. Enough to fight quite a good insurgency, probably not enough to give all the welfare out that he'd like. The 1.9 billion, most of it oil, much of it sold to Assad's regime, amazing. But that was a big source of income that is now, as his territory shrinks, drying up. They reckon last year he had 870 million, and yeah, those numbers will presumably decrease as he gets less territory. Al-Qaeda, you could argue most of its problems are in the past. After 9/11, the United States launched this ferocious, you know, unimaginably big attack on Al-Qaeda. It was only a few thousand people at that time, and yet, you know, the whole force of the Western world was deployed basically to destroy them, and it sort of worked. They, you know, in the areas that I deal with in Western Pakistan, Eastern Afghanistan, they were basically routed. Many of them ended up in Guantanamo. Many of them fled to their homes, and the whole, yeah, Bin Laden eventually was killed, and the whole outfit was significantly reduced. So the attacks on the West from Al-Qaeda basically dried up. And even though their policy is still to fight the far enemy, to fight the head of the snake, to fight the Americans, the fact is that they can only really mount local attacks, and they are now, you know, doing attacks in Yemen, North Africa, Somalia, and so on, but it's nothing like the movement it once was. So, looked at that way, you know, that's where Al-Qaeda's come from. There are those who argue that it's more resilient than we think, and that particularly in Yemen and North Africa, Al-Qaeda has hung on, and it has remained a potent force with considerable support in Nigeria, the Middle East, North African countries, Somalia, and particularly Yemen. And that it will be able to emerge from this as the stronger of the two movements. And that as Islamic State is forced onto the back foot in Syria, Iraq, and also it's almost happened now in Libya, the little bit they had there is almost gone, that Al-Qaeda will be seen as the one actually that has the longer lasting power. Now, just to put this into some sort of context as the violent jihadists see it, because we tend to work, you know, to either 4-year electoral cycles or even 24-hour news cycles, these guys really don't. And if you talk to jihadist ideologues, as I do quite a bit, they see it in terms of decades or centuries. So they really are not bothered. Raqqa's gone, whatever. But long term, we will prevail. That is how they see it. Just look where I started with all these reverses the West has faced in the last 20 years, and that is how they see it. Say, look, okay, we've had a bad year. We've had a very good 20 years. And if we look at it further ahead, we'll have a very good 50 years and a very good 100 years. And you guys in the West will get exhausted and we will prevail. And of course, as you look at some of the things that are holding everything together in the Middle East, such as, let's say, the Saudi royal family, yeah, a significant force opposing Al-Qaeda and Islamic State and, you know, massive resources in the Middle East, you know, it is not unimaginable that one day that system will collapse. So what would happen then? How different would things look then? They would look very, very different. And as people from the jihadist side say, that's not outside the realms of possibility. May take 20 years, may take 30 years. But if it happens, they will be looking in a much stronger place than they are now. That's not to say that there aren't issues for them. I think long-term issues for them. So particularly the anti-Shia violence is, I think, a double-edged sword for Islamic State. And, you know, there's no doubt that it has, as Zakawi envisioned, envisioned, it has helped them build support in their campaign in Iraq and Syria at the moment. But if you look further ahead, I mean, we can all look ahead to what's going to happen now in Mosul. So Mosul, Iraq's second city, controlled by Islamic State very brutally for a couple of years. And of course, most people in the city are actually desperate to be liberated by the Iraqi army. And that will happen, as I say, over the next 3 months, probably. But what will happen then? Well, what will happen then is that Shia militia groups, the army in Iraq, so weakened after its disbandment by the Americans, has been incapable of retaking Mosul. It has needed the support of Shia militia groups who've been paid for and armed by Iran to help this campaign in Mosul. So you now have a situation where in 3 months' time, Shia militia groups will be running around Mosul, killing people. And when that happens, the resentment of the Sunni population there will be great. So this sectarian divide will have taken yet another escalatory step. And it is a long-term problem. It's a problem that Islamic State don't see. They think it's a useful way to proceed, to deepen this sectarian split. But most people in the West, I think, would see this sectarian split, and many Muslims would see the sectarian split, as significantly weakening long-term the capacity of these groups to prevail and to get their way. So we can see this, just finally just to sort of wrap up with this thought, we can see all this in terms of what happened after the Arab Spring. So the Arab Spring was a significant challenge to these violent jihadist groups. We had people on the streets demanding change and demanding an end to these democratic regimes. And the violent jihadists were absolutely absent in that debate. They had nothing to say about it. They were not involved in provoking those street protests and encouraging them and organizing them. They were simply not there. And so suddenly you found significant numbers of Middle Eastern youth demanding a better future without any reference to the violent jihadists. So if you look at it this way, over since the 60s, the universities in the Middle East, which had been dominated by left-wing Marxist thought, anti-colonialist Marxist thought, all the students G'd up by those kind of ideas. And then there'd been this switch to people being much more interested in the power of Islam to resist Western colonialism rather than Marxism or their socialist ideas. They'd run through nationalism as well, Arab nationalism, which has not worked. And so you've got, they'd arrived in this place where Islamism was exciting and a possible agent of change. And then, when the Arab Spring happened, Islamists were not there. And so it was a major blow to them. The Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt got there months late, saying, we better back this, right at the end of it, rather than at the beginning of it. And that was, obviously, a major opportunity. However, the fact is the Arab Springs, as we can now see, have all failed. The repression that is going on in Egypt and in Syria, in Bahrain and other places, is plain to see. And so you have now another possibility for the jihadists to make the case that if you want change, if you want to change your lives, you want to overthrow these regimes and not providing jobs, not providing a decent living, not providing any security, massive abuses of state power, that if you want to avoid all that, then come to us, the jihadists, and we will show you a way out of it. So that long-term risk is there. And of course, there are those in the West, including some of the American military, who said, what we need to do to combat this failure of the Arab Spring is to pump money in, is to make these revolutions successful. Well, that's gone. I mean, the money's not there in the West now, the inclination is not there, and clearly that's not how this is going to go. So we'll have to see the long-term impact of the failure of the Arab Spring, but it may well be that the jihadis will prevail. So that's how I see it in terms of their opportunities and problems, and the West, with reduced really to this rather cynical strategy, may not be deliberately adopted, but nonetheless relying on sectarian Sunni Shia division as the main agent of weakening the jihadi movement, enabling the Western powers to prevail. So are they rivals or friends? So clearly in the short term they are rivals, they issue these foul statements about each other, and they are in conflict really as rival groups in Syria and many other parts of the world. But if you look at it in the long term, and many of their more thoughtful members would look at it in the long term, then it may be that 10, 20, 30, 50, 60, 100 years down the road, the distinctions between groups like Islamic State and Al-Qaeda will look like mere details, sort of doesn't really matter, you know, it's a sort of flowery detail compared to the broad sweep of events which could enable them to take over more power in the Middle East. So I'm very glad to take any questions. That's